Ready to start? Thank you. It was a lovely lunch, thank you. Great, wonderful. So our moderator is joining us on the stage. If everybody could please give us the moment to quiet down and to come and sit down so that we can begin. Thank you. Could somebody please go over to that area and ask everybody to quiet down? Thank you.
Consumer interest. of some of the best in class brands that we think are really doing this. So recently we're highlighting the Lueve baskets. Lueve is a Spanish luxury brand exploring the traditional basketry, most recently at Milan Design Week. They used a signature naturally dyed leather, and it really elevated the woven containers and baskets that were made with strips of leather and bamboo. In the center, we have Dion Lee, and designed by them. Dion Lee is an Australian-based brand, and they developed a collection compromising a lounge chair and a bench made by slashed weaving and of leather. And this collaboration really aimed to unite the designer's experimental approach with the clothing company, also with designed by them, for a very minimalist aesthetic. And it really created a dynamic, robust, and comfortable piece of furniture. And the last one, which is very, very exciting here, is the 2020 Bentley Flying Spur. So most recently, Bentley actually announced that the Flying Spur will use a new type of leather upholstery with a three-dimensional diamond effect without traditional stitching. So really combining the whole idea of 3D technology and almost digital, things that look digitized and things that are very handcrafted. Following that is Slow Living. So slow living is something the consumer wants more and more. We all need to slow down. We all need to kind of de-digitize and unplug. We're shifting away from this whole idea of things that are new to things that are necessary and functional. We're extending the product life cycle through the chain of consumption, which is both impacting design and development, retail strategies, and post-purchase decision-making. And these are all things we talked about this morning, but it is important to consider through a consumer's view. The other important thing to think about is how government legislation is actually impacting this as well and has having a role. So it's really forcing those who have not played the sustainability game and really encouraging the shift in consumer attitude for what we truly need. So people that are doing this successfully. So the first one I really, really love, personal anecdote. I have a pair of leather ballerina flats by a French company, and I have had them for years and years and years, and my significant other keeps trying to throw them away. And I keep saying, like, no, they're perfectly worn in, they're perfectly aged, I can't live without them. So what I love, what Red Wing Shoes is doing, they're a Minneapolis-based company, and they make boots for heavy construction, but they recently opened up a pop-up or a full-line store actually in Midtown Manhattan, and you can visit the store for repair services. You can also send it in, but you can speak with any type of sales associate, really learn about the history of your product, get the professional appropriate footwear for yourself, and certainly engage with the brand and create a better relationship. The second one, we'd like to talk about slow travel as well. So the example here is the Rovos Training Tour, and that is an opportunity to discover Africa. It's all about a slow pace for railroad travel, and it's completely done, each car is completely done in leather, so it is absolutely the most comfortable. It goes all the way from South Africa to Cape Town over 2 days, and it's a really comfortable ride. And then the last one is an Italian leather goods company, if I butcher this, I apologize, but it's Il Bolsont. And they highlight, they also opened up their first US standalone store in the United States. And they really talk about the beauty and the aging process of leather. They really embraced positive aging. They offer paid refreshing services for weather bean bags. So if you have, you know, an old bag that you don't want to get rid of and your significant other keeps wanting to throw it away, you don't want to, you can bring it to them and they'll revive it for you. Coming up next is comfort. So at first I was like, how am I going to connect comfort and leather besides like wearing in old bean shoes? So there's this focus on wellness. It's combining a shift of working from home. Actually, by, I want to say 2020, later next year or in the next couple of years, we know that 75% of millennials and other generations are actually going to be working remotely from home and from home. So it's all about finding a balance between comfort and aesthetics, and all about focusing on both relaxation, rejuvenation, and self-care. So how does leather play into this? Well, in a couple of different examples. So there's the Shinola Hotel. The Shinola is, as you know, is the American luxury goods brand based out of Detroit. They produce both watches, bicycles, and all sorts of fantastic leather goods. And they recently entered the hospitality market with a hotel that is completely furnished with their fine leather goods. The second, Estera Crystal Healing Footwear. So from a cultural space, we actually are always talking about alternative methods of healing. And this was a really interesting example because it combined both footwear and leather and crystals for healing. All of the crystals that are on these shoes are actually Reiki charged. And are supposed to help not only sustain you, but sustain life of the shoe. So it's supposed to not only incorporate ancient healing techniques with style, but it's very next level glowy. So if you want to combine crystals and footwear, this is your opportunity. And the next one here is another brand, Italian brand. It's called, I guess I'll mention this again, but Extata, and it's an outdoor design company. It elevates the pleasure of exteriors with products born from this Italian craftsmanship, and every material is processed meticulously with care and compassion and is completely perfect for summer lounging. Next up, we have personalization. So this is really an evergreen idea, but it is not going away. It really continues to appeal to consumers who are increasingly choosing products and services that resonate with them on a very individual level. So as I mentioned before, we know now the consumer is a belief-based buyer and wants to only buy brands and goods that really represent them. As a business strategy, what's really important here is that it can reduce waste, eliminate markdown, and improve overall engagement with the consumer. So brands doing this well. A couple examples here. First, one of my favorite ones in terms of personalization is called Goodwin Smith. It's men's shoes that can be customized with tattoo designs. So we've seen embroidery, we've seen painting, but this whole idea of tattooing leather, especially on footwear, was very interesting to us. They recommend having artwork done by their resident tattoo artist, or you can certainly submit in your own. In the middle is Mansour Gavrel, oldie but a goodie, but absolutely love the whole idea of painted monogramming, especially as an exclusive motif that consumers can come and engage with in store. And on the very right, Story Leather, which is a premium handcrafted genuine leather good. And we love this example because it's with car keys. So certainly you can typically personalize like notebooks or all types of like leather goods, but we absolutely love those for our car key. Fob, especially when I was picking up my car the other day, they were all just like black keys. I couldn't even find them, but if I had this, I would have been able to find it quickly and online. Okay, next up, most importantly, storytelling. What's great is leather is really alive with stories. It's got the story of the earth, of the animal, of the craftsman, of the wearer, and even someone who's inheriting this piece. And each of us who comes in contact with leather adds a new layer of meaning and a new history. Examples that we're really loving in this space is a brand called Italic. It is like calls itself the ultimate DTC brand. It offers better value to the equation, especially with like the right product at the right price. So what they do is make leather goods that they say come from the same manufacturers as your favorite quote unquote designer brands, but without the logo and without the markup. And Gemmi is in the middle, another great one in terms of Italian craftsmanship and storytelling, small artisanal workshops, really furthering the craft and aims to share the sense of discovery, of quality, and of passion. And I absolutely love visiting their store. You can touch all the different leather swatches, look at all the different colors, really personalize your shoe, and really kind of have a better understanding of where your footwear comes from. And the last one, Brother Vellies, is another great brand which helps support artisanal jobs all over the world, both in South America and in parts of Africa. They're typically made with kudu leather, which is an animal byproduct resulting from a government mandate culling overpopulation. And it's really supposed to be that forever shoe, so something you kind of keep and wear and appreciate as it ages. Last one, which is obviously a very, very big topic, is sustainability. And obviously this is like a big, wicked challenge to unpack. But what's really interesting to pay attention to is the consumer attitude of ownership has really changed. And what this means is they are now have access to the sharing economy. They're prioritizing spending over experience over product, and they're really paying attention to the circular economy. And that's part of this really regenerative process that we again talked about this morning, but it's really the newest form of sustainability, and circular design is absolutely crucial when designing product and ideating. So a couple examples here that really are across industries. Something I want to mention right now, and I'll talk about this a little bit through here, is you really have to think about both the rental and the whole idea of re-commerce in terms of strategy. Those are the two biggest ways consumers are now actually consuming and engaging with product. There was even a collaboration this past week with Armarium, which is a high-end women's wear styling platform with What Goes Around Comes Around, which is a resale store that's been around for quite a while. They called it their bought and borrowed pop-up, and they brought together stylists and fashion expertise and highlighted like different popular adaptions of the circular economy and like the new ways to build a modern wardrobe. So I thought that was such a strong example of two brands holding these spaces coming together to create a new type of engagement with the consumer. Additional examples here are Burrow. So if you've heard of all the different mattress companies like Purple or whatnot, they'll deliver a mattress right to your door. This is Burrow, and they'll deliver a beautiful $3,000 mattress right to your door. So it's a sofa in the box. They're all luxurious leather sofas. They have a really beautiful mid-century modern design, and it's really appealing to millennials as they want to try out some investment pieces without necessarily the commitment. Rebag in the Center, that's another great example of what we call the re-commerce. They now have online and brick-and-mortar stores that encourage customers to buy, sell, and repeat. They have a wonderful sustainable cycle of endless luxury, so you can purchase a bag, you can try it out, and if in X amount of months you decide you actually don't want it anymore, you can sell it back to them for a quite significant amount and still utilize whatever you make to a credit to a new bag, so really keeping that process going. And the last one is Deadwood. It was another great example of both reusing leather and recycling it. They rescue dead stock skins and repurpose vintage clothes and upcycle post-production waste. We talked about that a little bit this morning again, but it's for someone who really wants to engage with leather, but also wants to be a little bit more conscientious of their spending. How they engage with leather. So really what they're doing is they chop up old leather garments that reach their expiration in terms of style or wear, and then they utilize it to make beautiful new jackets. So that's mostly it. I just want to re-highlight Fashion Snoops. We do this and more. We work from a macro cultural inspiration to really specific soft goods. We utilize data and AI, which really differentiates us. And we work with lots of different brands in terms of go-to-market strategies and planning for future trend events. If you're interested in talking with us a little bit more, again, my name is Michelle Brokart. You can also reach our sales team. They're right over here in the corner. Amanda's texting, but I'll give her a shout. Let's bring up our next guests. Okay, so if I could please have Liz come up, Massimo and Carrie. Very graciously have joined us for the afternoon. Yeah, go ahead. Okay, guys, thanks again so much for being here with us. I'm going to ask you all one overarching big question, and then I'll have you introduce yourselves and kind of give us a little bit of answer, and then I know some of you have presentations as well. Cool? Okay, so my first big question is, since we talked a lot about leather and consumer wants and values, what is your experience in leather, and how does it serve today's values, and how does it resonate with consumers' desires? Liz, let's start with you.
Consumer values.
I guess we're passing it around. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and your background?
Well, starting with me first.
Yeah, sure.
Well, I'm going out on a limb here, and I'm going to tell you that I'm the only bassoonist who has sat up here on the stage today. Right? Did I win the prize? I think I did. So my background is actually in music, and while all the other cool kids were out doing cool kid things, I was home making bassoon reeds, which you may know, if you're nerdy like me, are made from bamboo. Bamboo has a lot to do with how we make leather. So I was soaking my bamboo, I was splitting it, I was drying it, I was carving it, and eventually I made bassoon reeds out of it. So I found myself many years later in the leather world, where I am today, working for Coach, doing something very similar. I'm taking a raw material, which many of you participate in providing to us, so I thank you very much for that. And we're trying to make beautiful things out of it. So I brought an example of a Coach bag. This was on our last runway show. And I don't know if any of your hides went into this bag, but if they did, thank you very much. And I'm very lucky in the position I'm in at Coach today because Coach was founded in 1941. Many of you probably know the brand. And we come from a history of leather. The brand was a leather goods company from the start, and we continue to try to promote and use leather in every way that we can. And we pride ourselves as a team on being very well educated in terms of how we procure that leather, making sure it's from a responsible source, making sure it's beautiful, so that we can then translate that value to our customer. So that's a little bit about my background and Coach background. Is that a good kickoff?
Yeah. So I'm going to ask you one more question. You mentioned working with Coach, and you also talked a lot about, when we met, sustainability being a key issue for leather. So can you tell us a little bit about leather sustainability strategy at Coach and Tapestry?
Yeah, this is my new favorite subject, actually, and I think it's incredibly meaty and so interesting and also really messy, which also interests me, but that's a side salad. We have very clear goals that we have put out in the industry for 2025, and you know, Coach is part of Tapestry, so we own Kate Spade and Stuart Weitzman as well. And specifically around leather, we focused on traceability and LWG gold and silver status for our sourcing strategy in leather. Now, those both sound really good, and we're very proud of both of those goals, in addition to a number of other goals which are on our website. You're welcome to go and read more about them. But there's so much more to be done. And one thing that I would like to make sure that all of you guys understand, and hopefully my colleagues here will pipe in on this one as well, is there's so much information out there that I believe the biggest challenge we have as a group, because I think we're all in this together, from leather manufacturers, they want to be called tanners, leather manufacturers to packers to LWG to chemical suppliers from Stahl, is that we all have an ultimate frustration that our customer really isn't understanding the value of leather today. And if they think that becoming vegan means that they shouldn't carry a leather bag, we have to make sure that we're educating our internal customers, our external customers, in an impactful, sexy way so that they get it. And talking about LWG to a Coach customer in a store is not going to cut it. They don't know what LWG is, right? That's not sexy. So one thing that I would like us to try to work hard on together is to share as much information as we possibly can and educate all of us on where we are today and where we need to go. I just did a total soapbox on you.
It's okay. We like it.
Okay.
Anything else?
I think you're
pretty fast. I would drop it at the end.
Hi,
Gary.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm doing good.
Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and also answer the same question I asked before about how you think, how does leather serve today's values and how does it resonate with the consumer and their desires?
Absolutely. So Gary Brosna, I've been at Wolverine Worldwide for 7 years. Wolverine houses 12 fantastic brands that I get to work with every day, which is a great opportunity for me. I'm also a 25-year student of the leather industry. I started my career in leather 25 years ago. To say where leather fits the values of the end consumer today, I think what we talked about today in all the presentations prior to this, which were fantastic, by the way, was that, and you actually brought it up just a minute ago, sustainability is a key word. And despite the buying practices of the end consumer, they find it important. But what's even more important is what you're going to find here is from the brand point of view, is regardless of the buying habits of the end consumer, we're going to make sustainability a normal part of our business. And once that becomes the norm, obviously that's what people will have to buy. What Frank brought up today a little bit about the population growth, and the really interesting thing is he had that big piece of paper that represented the size of the earth, and then he cut it in a quarter and said this is the size of land. The land mass isn't growing. And if the land mass isn't growing and we're going to go from 6 billion to 10 billion people, where are we going to put waste? The answer is there's not a lot of space. So we've got to figure out an alternative way to make things. We need to make things that last longer, that can be renewed, like we've been talking about today with leather. You put a little polish, a little oil, you bring it back to life, you bring it into a cobbler, you have it resold, and these uppers can last for a very, very long time. Things that last longer means you throw less things away. And that's what we do.
That's awesome. Thank you. And I know you have a presentation I'm going to come back to, okay?
Cool.
Hi, Massimo.
Hi, everyone.
How are you?
I'm good. I think I am the only one here. Yes. At least on the stage.
I like your shoes.
Thank you. So, same question?
Same question, yes. If you could tell us a little bit about your background and then also how you see leather serving to
So, leather has been my life since the beginning, coming from a shoe family. That has been everything. Mom and Dad didn't want me to be here. They've been doing everything possible to throw me out from this industry. But the smell of the leather takes you back all the time. There is no way. The beauty of this fantastic material. What is leather for our consumer? I believe any leather is on us. We have leathers, and we love the leathers that we are using. There is a commonality between ourselves and what we use every day. We try always to match back with that. I heard about sustainability, I heard about our population, I heard about all this fantastic part of today's concern. I think we need to go back to the origin. We, as a consumer, have been driving this industry and leading this industry, I want to say, in the wrong way. Luckily today, the new consumer, the new generation, are driving back this industry and leading the industry in the right way, which is like it was 40 years ago, 50 years ago, probably. That is something that is on us. We can make the change. It is very challenging. But I truly believe that especially the new generation that are sitting into this crowd will help us to go in that direction.
That's great. So I'm going to have two more questions for you, and I believe you have a presentation. Yes? Okay, so when we spoke a little bit earlier, you talked about the evolution of the supply chain.
Yeah.
Can you comment on that?
Well, you know, as Italian, we always believe that everything is best made in Italy.
Yes.
And inside of Italy, we do believe that there are certain regions that they do better certain things, like, you know, the best meat is out of Tuscany, right? But I have to be honest, the evolution in general of the supply chain, the globalization of the supply chain, has been pairing with the globalization of the consumer. So as well as the consumer has access to the goods from all over the world, we have been able to access, and more than that, to have being able to use the excellence in different parts of the world. Craftsmanship that we can find today in Asia are absolutely comparable to what we can find in Italy, I want to say. Italy might have expertise on the workers that are more skillful. For sure, that's something. There is an evolution in general, also in some part of Asia, in terms of industry, what industries are sitting in what area. And this is an evolution. This is part also an evolution of the country in terms of welfare. That will be part of the conversation later. The supply chain today is a global supply chain. We'll get leather from Italy, we will get embellishment from China, we'll get the coir from Brazil, from Italy. This is the global supply chain. There has been a moment where, you know, each brand can decide which lane to pick. And that we need to be also very careful with what we call sustainability, about the footprint we leave on the environment in terms of transportation. But my vision is today, especially following where the consumer are leading in terms of needs, it's more about excellence, about meeting the expectation of our customers, being able to deliver beautiful products. And we can source those products in different parts of the world.
That's great. Last question. You've talked a lot about excellence. How do you see the designer and luxury brands adapting to this new market?
That's an interesting question. I was, 1 year ago, there was a conversation internally in my company. By the way, I haven't said who I am. Sorry. Massimo Bettio. I'm the vice president of footwear for Tory Burch, and I'm honored to be able to work in such an amazing environment as Tory Burch is. So during that time, there was a big conversation about how we can approach the new consumer, millennials, Generation Z, Generation X, and so on. And we had several consultant companies coming in and, you know, explaining the values of the consumer, as you just explained before. Someone made a statement, and please don't get me wrong. Zara and H&M are bread. For me, it was kind of an insult. A brand has an history. Brand has a DNA. A brand has values to sell. It's not a provider of product. I believe that the new generation are more savvy. They know what they want, and they choose the brand that can deliver the message to them with the history and the DNA they have. Of course, in terms of buying, those brands might be expensive. So at the first, they go and buy goods from less expensive that look alike. But as soon as they get the opportunity to buy those brands, they're gonna buy from them. That is the challenge for the brands, being able to combine what the consumer wants, the new revolution of the market in terms of what the consumer needs, also from the market, but also going back to the sustainability part, and keeping the DNA of the brand, having the DNA always staying inside of the brand. This is the most important portion. B, building a brand, building an history. I want to say nowadays is almost impossible. So who has that has to keep it very tight and use it in order to transform their product according to the needs of the market without losing this DNA.
That's great, thank you. And I'm hearing you have a presentation to share with us.
As I said before, I'm the vice president of Body Verge for footwear, and I want to start with this. And this is me. plenty of pictures inside of the factory, was my playground. I can't remember how many times I fell asleep into the desk of my bed. Time I had my bicycle with holes because I was running around the production line and there was all those stuff going out because they were taking out all the stuffs from the shoes. And you know, that was it. That was my life. As I said, growing up, I had to work during summertime in the factory, lasting shoes, cleaning up the shoes. That was, again, life. But mom and dad didn't want me to be there. So they basically support me in anything. And as all the other kids, we have passion. Someone wanna be a firefighter, someone wanna be a singer, someone wanna be an actor, someone. I wanted to be a military pilot. And eventually I made it. I entered the Air Force. From someone that is in from Florence, if you know the Scuola di Guerra, I did the Scuola di Guerra, became a pilot in the Air Force in Italy for 3 years. And do you remember the Kuwait War? Yeah, they sent me there. It was not fun. So I decided that despite my love for flying, I wanted to, you know, go back to the real life. And the only thing that I knew was about shoes. I didn't know anything else. In the meantime, I was studying at the University of Venice architectural, but I didn't have my degree yet. So I needed a job. Mom and dad didn't want me to get back. So, you left an opportunity, now you need to take care of yourself. So I started working in a very old company. Was at that time just becoming 100 years old. Ski boots and mountaineering shoes, Dolomite. Fantastic company based in Montebelluna. Everything was done in-house, from design, development, production. Had the chance to learn about how to make molds, how to make there was the beginning of the 3D construction and fast prototyping that today is like amazing. You can do fast prototyping and buying a fast prototyping machine for $90 a day. At that time it was probably $900,000. the new evolution. Right after that, I went working for Fila, Fila Sport, and then one day I received a phone call from an adult. And they wanted to talk to me about an opening they had into a luxury brand. I was not at all, I mean, you see me today? I was the opposite. That's my friend Alan, I was like him.
Like him. Alan looks like a fashionable guy, I don't know. I got you, Alan, don't worry.
So I went to the interview, and the only name that stayed in my mind was Yves Saint Laurent. So then they called me a couple of days after, and they go, are you available for another meeting with the president? And I go, yes, so you need to go to Paris, and you go to the Louis Vuitton. on palette. And I go, I can always use some of that. So that was my knowledge about luxury, zero. Okay. Got hired, they moved me to Paris 1 year, and then after that, start moving around myself in different companies of Louis Vuitton Maison Zero. First I was in Berluti, then I went to Celine, then I was back in Louis Vuitton, all in Italy. After that, I was a little bit tired of the French. Don't say that to my CEO today. Which was my CEO today, by the way. I went working for Dolce & Gabbana Industria in Florence, taking all the D&G back to the company. D&G, the second line at that time, was managed by ETF. Was a beautiful, beautiful experience, being able to source new vendors, being able to hire people, being able to build a new division was fantastic. But I was young. I was just 36 years old. And all the other, as many other of us, I mean, when you have a great career and you grow that fast, you are a little bit full of yourself, which was my mistake. I was full of myself. And I started thinking about, you know, why should I make the other rich? Why I cannot do something for myself, right? I wanna be an entrepreneur. I'm coming from that family. I wanna be like that. And I, you know, I did my own company. It was a designing company in the beginning, and then after, we start sourcing, making sample, production, blah, blah, blah. Eventually, we end up with a company that, and I say we because there was a team, worth about, in terms of turnover, 15 million euros at that time, which was not bad, okay? But I was just sharing with someone before, that experience made me 30 years older. So, a big shout to all the entrepreneurs inside of this crowd, to all your employers. There is a lot behind that. I have a high respect for Tory. Tory Burch Company is just 14 years old, and getting from zero to $1.4 billion turnover, it is not easy. And so I have highest respect in front of all the entrepreneurs. So after that, I said to myself, you know what, I want to go back to life. I was, at that time, I opened also an office in New York, so I was often in New York, and I met the CEO of Berluti, which was I was working with, and all of a sudden, I decided that I wanted to go back, so I went to Marc Jacobs in New York, and then after ABCBG myself in Los Angeles, and now I'm back. So that's more or less my career. So I want to just share quickly about how many minutes? 10 minutes?
Yeah, we have like 5 to 7 minutes.
So I want to show you. That is what I said in, but this is how many things you can say about my life. And this is just randomly. It's a lot. And you keep going. And, you know, it will finish. So this is what I saw and learned along the way. What I learned along the way is that, and that led me to the different steps, which is, this is it. This is the reality. The reality is us as a consumer. I had in my mind the idea that as a we industry were leading. We're leading what the consumer wants. Luckily today the consumer are taking the ownership. They decide what they want. We decide what we want. And we are all more knowledgeable. We know what we know. We know about the material constructions, about the right prices, and we are more solid. We also have a better understanding of this beautiful world where we live, which it's just one. We don't have multiple choices. This is it. We can just take this one. And it is like our life. It's up to us how we treat ourselves. And it is the same about where we live today. So if we are able today in capturing today this transformation, you know, I was having a conversation with a friend about this moment. And I made an analogy. He said, you're wrong. My analogy today is that this time to me is like the Industrial Revolution that happened in the past. Someone is saying, no, the digital revolution has been bigger. I think today we do not understand we are making a revolution. We are making a revolution. And the revolution is led by us, not by the industry. We, us, as a consumer, are leading this revolution. And the revolution will be about human centered. I've been listening before about how can we help emerging countries, about corporate responsibilities and so on. We have to do it. We have to help everyone. We have to help everyone in order to create a sustainable life. Life, sustainability, it translated in just two words, it is the footprint that we leave into the world. Less we leave, better we can live in this world. I truly believe that the new generation that are sitting here have the possibilities to lead us as humanity in a better world. But I have just one upside. Please be patient. I know you have been studying a lot. I know you have been investing a lot of your time. But that's not it. It's not finished. You still have a long way. And you can learn from the, can I say about myself, dinosaurs, okay? We can learn. I'm still amazed sitting beside my father and having him sole in the shoes. It's beautiful. Beautiful, going to a tannery and seeing how they treat the leather. It's amazing seeing all these processes.
That's my question. Thank you. Very inspiring.
So to gain market share in the footwear category, we have to realize that in today's world and with today's consumer, leather is beautiful, but it's a material. And it competes where, you know, the full grain used to compete with the split, and the split competed with pigskin, and et cetera, et cetera, and then there was goat and sheep. Today, it's one vast opportunity of materials for all of the new designs. designers. So what we need to do on the leather side to regain that market share is we need to differentiate. We need to understand that the brands are looking for great stories, and we need to pass on the great story of leather to the brand so that they can pass that on to their end consumer. We need to follow the diamond of success in terms of we need to make sure that our product is right, we need to make sure that our customer service is right, and one of the biggest things today is delivery in full on time. The end consumer today is very impatient. We talked a little bit today about just-in-time manufacturing, and I've argued for many years that the end result of just-in-time manufacturing means that not everybody's just-in-time. It means a lot of people have to be early. They have to be ready, right, beforehand. So those are some of the key things to regaining market share, just in summary, differentiation, explaining where we come from, where we go, why we're better than many of the alternatives that can be chosen today.
That's great. Thank you.
All right. So first of all, I have to apologize because when Frank showed that chart, I was in that age category where we ate more than the recommended amount of proteins. And as of last night, I think we need to reset that upper limit because we definitely blew it out of the water. So apologies there. So imagine if we had a beautiful product manufactured sustainably by partner suppliers committed to continuous improvement and innovation. Imagine then that the raw material used to make this product is durable, renewable, versatile, and plentiful. You might notice that I stole a couple of those adjectives from earlier presentations. Finally, imagine this product created was desired by the end consumer globally. If all of these things meet in the universe, then we've got something, right? And we are there. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about a brand take on what's important from the consumer view. I'm going to share with you just a little bit of the data that we look into in a couple of the surveys that we've taken that kind of focus in on that bullseye that is the consumer and the consumer need. Before I do that, could I just ask a show of hands, number of people that are involved in this room from the packer side or hide selling side or hide production side? Okay, so put up your fingers, number one, and keep those up. The forefinger, please, not the middle one. Okay, so number two, how many people are here from the tanning and chemical industries? You're gonna do two fingers. Okay, number three, designers and brands, including young designers. Okay, so this is one of those events that connects these three parts or multiple parts of making footwear. And it's a tremendous experience that we have here because typically, if you go a couple of steps back in the supply chain, they don't get the opportunity to talk to the end consumer or to the designer. The designer doesn't necessarily talk to the people who produce hides. Things that happen in the hide market are 12 months before the design cycle is over. So what that means is if prices go up or down, the hide guys might not see any change in their business. Specifically, if they go up, like they did in 2013, they don't see the result of that for 12 months. So things keep chugging along and chugging along, and all of a sudden, that ripple hits the shore, and boom, the leather business drops, right? And what happens after that is that then it takes another 12 months to get back, because then the prices drop, and then they get back into that cycle. So meetings like this join all of those stakeholders together and give us a real opportunity. So I'm gonna move rather quickly through this, but what I'd like to do is give you a little picture of some of the things that we do as a brand and what we look at. First of all, knowing who our consumer is and knowing what they want. This is a generational report done by Cassandra, and I'm gonna focus on the highlighted Gen Y in the interest of time. Not to say that the roughly 133 million people and baby boomers and Gen Xers aren't important, but what we have to understand is that both in the Gen X and baby boomer population, if you look down to that very important spending power line, those spending power numbers are gonna start to decline. And as Americans, as we enter retirement, we typically spend 30% less than where we were gainfully employed. So we're gonna look at that 75 million that's Gen Y and what's important to them. I'm gonna use another survey to talk about the four things that we've been told are important to that millennium consumer. The first one is comparable for all of the generations, and that is high quality product, right? Who doesn't want a high quality product? And what it means in this instance is that high quality means that it's a value for what you're paying for in the final product, that it lasts long, because as we mentioned, people want things to last longer so that they throw away less. And that it's something that they can keep nice. It can't just last a long time, but they want it to look nicely. The second thing is a little bit different. This is where we start to move away in the millennial generation, is they want a product that supports their individuality. So in the baby boomers and Gen Xers, I won't volunteer for which one I am, the idea was we buy from great brands that we can trust and have great product. In the millennial generation, they like brands, but they also like their individuality. These people ask their friends for input on the product that they buy, but they're not necessarily going to wear the same things that their friends wear. The next one is responsible manufacturing. They want their products made responsibly, and I'll get into that in the next slide. And then the final thing is they want brands that represent who they are. And this is why you find great brands today, great running brands like Saucony, that spend time at all of the races, big and small, where their consumers are running. They want to know firsthand how the consumers are feeling in their footwear. That's why great brands like Sperry and Merrell and Chaco spend time on the ocean front or the riverfront or the mountains where their consumers are, so they can identify firsthand what the opportunities are and what the challenges are for their consumers that need to be solved. And the next step, we're going to talk a little bit about that word sustainability. And in 1997, which is a few years ago, a gentleman wrote a book about the triple bottom line in business. And the triple bottom line is what I call a three-legged stool. The reason I do that is I've had a lot of negative experiences on a three-legged stool. When one leg breaks or it's not so sturdy, what happens? The stool falls, right? So the triple bottom line is really the model that I think best gives us an example of where sustainability can live. Sorry about that. So it takes consideration people, profit, and plan, right? And then in between where those circles merge, that's where we can have sustainability. We're all interdependent. And if we ignore one of them, the other two will suffer and that stool will fall. So I wanted to keep this short because I was told 10 minutes and I also want to have time for questions, but we have all the tools available to us to find the answers for this new millennial generation, which is going to have a tremendous power and a tremendous spend. And in reality, this is the generation that is going to be our increase or decrease in market share for leather products. So extremely important to finish this up, that we make sure, as I said in the beginning, that we differentiate. We make people understand why leather is better, why it's important that they use a sustainable material. And number two is brands. As I said to Liz earlier, is that the end consumer isn't necessarily ready to open their pocket and spend more on a sustainable product versus a less sustainable option. But if we as brands take the lead, and you as suppliers take the lead with us, then we can change the dynamics of business and where this model will move forward. Thank you very much.
Question, which we'll kind of ask everyone. So since we talked a lot about the future and consumer, where do you see the industry moving in the next 5 to 10 years? And if you had a magic wand, how would you adjust to what's happening in the industry right now?
Okay. I definitely see a lot of anxiety in our industry right now, whether it's even within our own building. There's a lot of fear around global plastic straws anymore. People are very nervous. I don't know if you guys are nervous, but a lot of kids are nervous that I work with. And so I believe there will be a tipping point, and I think we're coming to it fairly quickly. Yesterday at LWG, we talked a little bit about some of the brands that are making a lot of noise on Business of Fashion and WWD, like Caring Group. You guys probably read that Stella McCartney is joining LVMH. That should be interesting. So there's a lot going on in the fashion world that is going to affect all of us. And I kind of liken it to food consumption. I know years ago we used to eat Spam and go to McDonald's for egg McMuffins and things like that. Many of us now spend more money on food, our own food, because we realize that organic is better, maybe grass-fed might be better, and we're willing to trade up for it. And there was a tipping point with food. And especially here in New York City, I don't know how many of you are from here, we spend a shit ton of money on food, okay? And I see that coming with fashion too. I don't believe that it's going to be cost neutral to do what we need to do. But I believe in our consumer, and I think a lot of what these gentlemen were talking about too resonates with all of us, that we can kind of capitalize on this fear, in not a bad way, but in a good way, to drive change and to help our consumer be as educated as we all need to be. And again, I go back to my point where we really need you guys to help us to have the knowledge to share with on our sexy platforms out to all of our consumers so that we can make that change. But I definitely think that it's not going away, and brands like ours, I probably agree, are either, we're in a sink or swim situation now, basically. What was the first thing I forgot now?
We kind of answered it, but if you had a magic wand, how would you love to adjust what's happening in the industry today?
If I had a magic wand in this moment in time, I would create a shared platform for information. Because every single person that I've talked to one-on-one over the last 48 hours who is in this industry has told me their passion project. Well, did you hear about this brand? They're doing that. I literally took the subway with my next door neighbor this morning, who was a journalist for Wall Street Journal. And she's like, but did you hear about this footwear brand? This is what they're doing, and they're da-da-da-da-da. There's so much information out there, and there's no one place for it to live. Even large organizations, like we were at LWG yesterday, or here we are in another large organization, or we're all going to be in Linea Pelle in Milan shortly, and we'll have another conversation there. But we're having too many siloed conversations. There are too many small things happening that are all coming from the best place. Everyone wants to do the right thing, but they're not going to be impactful enough to change as much as we need to change unless we start working together. I had a very nice conversation with my colleague Michael Kors yesterday, who, as you know, is my arch nemesis. But we and I said, you know, let's go have dinner, let's go have drinks, let's talk about it, let's figure it out. Let's, you and me, sit in a room and just pound it out. Like, what do we know? Who did you talk to? We're all calling the same person at Burberry. Like, why are we doing that? We should be sitting in a room having a brand conversation and including all the information that you highly intelligent people have out here. So if I had a magic wand, I would make that happen.
I like that. It's all about the sharing economy. Eric, same question, lightning round. Hot seat.
Magic wand. What Liz brought up is really important. And in our industry, I think we look at too many things as intellectual property. And in reality, within the brands or within the suppliers, there's two different things that we can work with. Number one is intellectual property, which we leave where it is. And the second is best practice. And if we work together to initiate and install best practice throughout the supply chain, throughout the design process. That's where we're going to make a big change in how things are done.
Thank you. Monster, same question. Lightning round hot seat. Magic wand.
The magic one for me would be leaving more the product with it. We really don't leave this product, we just want to sell it. The amount of development we do it is incredible. We have 70% drop rate, just to give you an idea. I think my colleagues have the same issues. We need to leave more our products and love it more. That's my magical one. I think sharing, we are doing, I want to just praise the Linea Pelle organization for today's meeting, because what we are doing here is sharing information. And I agree with Carrie, today we are putting together the three main components of this industry. We are missing the fourth one, unfortunately, which is the consumer, but we are all consumer, okay? So there are all the four components sitting into this room, and so I think in terms of more information, sharing information, I want to just go back to carrying intellectual property, very important for everyone, but we have an Italian sentence, segreto di Pulcinella, okay, doesn't exist. It's just a secret, a poor secret that we hide, but it is nothing. So we need to be able, really, there is nothing to hide. All the information should be available to everyone.
Thank you so much. Afterwards, we're very excited. Thanks, guys. I love all your answers. I love those magic wand questions. Okay, so can I please have Danielle, Steve, and Ari come up?
Consumers, they deserve to know the description of the material. It's a very, very big purchaser making when you talk about a vehicle, and they really do deserve to have that ability to understand what's inside that vehicle. So again, I'll talk more about it in a little bit, but it's we in our industry are at a crossroads.
Excellent, thank you. Danielle, same question. Will you please introduce yourself, tell us about yourself, and then tell us how you see leather connect with consumer values today?
I'm Daniele Gabini from Porto Marcao.
Sorry for my English. I work in Porto Marcao since 2001, and I'm the responsible of research and development for Porto Marcao. Porto Marcao is not only home furniture, but also contract division. Contract is everything is for public area. And the other department is interior emotion. Interior emotion is what everyone is movement. Car, boat, plane, etc. For Porto Marcao, leather is a big value because is our queen raw material.
I heard the seats that we're sitting
yes.
in are from Porto Marcao, very comfortable.
Can
I have some delivered to my home?
Oh, yes.
I like these.
My preference is this Archibald chair.
I'll have to try that one out later.
Yes, just in this year, is 10 years old, and is our new icon. First of these, the icon of Porto Marcao is the Vanity Fair, the Mickey Mouse chair.
Oh, wow, Disney.
And now, the new icon, because the volume of selling is best now, is this chair. Leather, like I say, is a big value for Porto Marcao. So, this is why more or less 15 years ago, Porto Marcao decided to create this office. First of this office don't exist. Each people that work in Porto Marcao know about leather. Our president in that moment want to achieve and give to the opportunities of this office to receive through all the legacy in leather that Porto Marcao has in that moment. So, like I say, is a big value because we create this office and work each day, me and my team, in research, but especially in development, because the very difficult is to bring the leather that is, I think, the most variability material that I know, bring this material in production to have objectivity of the work.
That's excellent. Thank you so much. I'm also a Norwalk. There you go, Parsons. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and answer that same question? How do you see leather resonating with today's consumer and their values and desires?
Sure. So I'm Ari. I'm a recent Parsons grad, and I'm in the process of starting my own brand, RE500. In terms of leather from an entrepreneurial perspective, I feel like leather is a material that has a different respect across the board from everybody across the world, internationally. There's a certain quality that leather brings to the table that no other material has been able to match. And people recognize that across all generations. I don't think that there is an adequate match to leather in terms of, you know, we can talk about vegan leather, we can talk about Pinatex. Nothing is comparable to authentic, really cowhide. So that's what I choose to work with.
Yeah, I know before you mentioned that leather is very versatile, and you just mentioned some of your preference, but why do you have a particular preference for one leather over another?
So in my collection, I decided to use veg tan, and I really wanted to use a leather that when you saw it, you could automatically recognize the quality that was there. And I also really enjoy the structure that comes with using veg tan. I use, I'm sure everyone knows, but 5 ounce veg tan. So there's no need for stabilizers in it. It holds its own shape and weight independently. And I really just like the simplicity that comes with it. There's a certain feel and give that veg tan has that I personally don't feel chromium can match. Chromium tan can match. So.
Absolutely. Thank you. And now I hear you have a presentation for us, is that right? And then can you answer one question for me before you go up? So we talked a little bit about all types of different leathers, but you and I also talked about what's happening with the, in terms of vegan and alternative materials. So what do you see happening with those, and how should the leather industry respond and communicate to the consumer?
This is an important point, because in the last time, our company must have information regarding leather asking from mass media, etc. So what I can say is that for leather for us is really important. So, not since now, but since different years, we work principally with Italian tannery that respect law and regulation, not only European but also international. And in the last 2-3 years, we work at a project that now for us is a reality that is looking for sustainability. It's clearly that leather come from an animal, but is a recycled material. What is our opinion? We must find the best solution for reduce the CO2 emission. So in this with this project, we work with a tannery that is not like a supplier, but for us is like a partner to reduce step by step in the production, start with the raw material that in this case is fresh, since the end transportation, minimize the CO2 reduction. And for us now this is a reality. But at the same time, we are looking for, like in this morning, about new material, for example, bio leather. We are stuck now. The time is very long, I think. But we are investigating because we want to give to our customer a solution and an answer regarding what Ottona Frau do about sustainability.
That's a really good point. It's very important to educate our consumers on what we're doing in our practices and our processes. Do you want to share your presentation with us? Thank you. There's a clicker right there. Click the green button. Maybe get some help from tech. Yeah? Cool. Thank you.
Probably more of you know that Poltrona Frau is a very old company. We have 107 years. We born in 1912 in Torino. When Mr. Renzo Frau, the Sardinian man, transferred from the island to Torino and started with this activity. Poltrona Frau came in Tolentino, where actually is based, in the 60 years, because in that year Poltrona Frau had a bankrupt.
So our actual president, Mr. Franco Moschini, that year, buy from Mr. Renzo Brown, just the logo and one person to work in Torino. And the adventure started like this. Intelligence on our hands is an apology that we created because we believe that craftsmanship is our storytelling.
The greatest stories are stories about love, and Poltrona Frau's story is one of these. Over 100 years of emotions which have seduced millions of people. The spark was struck in Turin. Renzo Frau, a resourceful upholsterer,
like I said, realized that his taste
was emerging deep within buildings and homes. That is how Poltrona Frau came to life. Its original armchairs in prized leather immediately captivated the public, charmed by the fitting interplay between modernity, brand, and communication. Poltrona Frau creates voluptuous icons, imitated by many, desired by all. The upper classes and Italian nobility choose them as a mark of prestige. Renzo dies soon after, and it is his wife who carries his dream forth. His vision remains and inspires Savina in the creation of ageless masterpieces, leading Poltrona Frau above and beyond. With the war, everything grinds to a halt. The economic boom brings a running start, and this time, unstoppable momentum. The company is purchased and moved to the Marche region, enhancing the values of its origins. It is the period of Franco Moschini's leadership, new collaborations, and timeless success. The world pursues change, and Poltrona Frau opens itself up to a revolution, embracing a modern design yet imbued with its own history. The renewal culminates with the birth of the interiors in motion and contract divisions. Now, Poltrona Frau's style also dresses offices and meeting places, and the world of travel. A fateful encounter leads into the new millennium, the company becomes a group, acquiring industry-leading brands. Fresh from the victory of the Design Wallpaper Award, the brand celebrates its centenary, and it does so with great style. Michele De Lucchi designs the Poltrona Frau Museum, where history looks to the future. 2 years later, the first showroom in China opens, a prelude for milestones in Asia and in the world, such as the Elle Decor International Design Award. Today, Poltrona Frau flies high, made strong by its long-lasting values, and part of a new international family. Its products confer prestige to the most sophisticated interiors in the world, to naval craft, and even to aeroplanes. A story of love, quality, and beauty, born from a brilliant mind. It still thrives in the hearts of those who it has charmed through the years.
Our first is Ferrari, but we work also for many other brand that is positioned in high end of quality that is in the car. Fortuna Frau Home is, let me say, everything is for furniture home, and we work, we have a cooperation since the 60 years when Mr. Franco Moschini buy Fortuna Frau with many architects, especially relationship is with Gianmarie Massola, you say, Mr. Michele De Lucchi, and so on and so on. Residential department is not only on furniture but also office. Office clearly not simply office because we are a luxury brand, but also office. Contract division, that is an important department for us. Work, like I say, not with the, yes. Contract division have a catalog of chair, but 90% of the job is customization. Interior motion is what everything is moved. Ferrari is the first supplier, but we work also for our previous brand. And the collaboration with the Ferrari started since more or less 2000. We are the owner of the leather for Ferrari, so not only leather, but also we cover more or less 50-60% of the car. It's not only all our job, but in the job that is a part of leather. But for us is really important because in the last year. I think that since 5 years ago, Ferrari produced more or less 7,700 cars per year. Now are more or less 9,000, and in the plan of the Ferrari for the next 2-3 years, they want to arrive to 12,000 cars per year. We also created a museum in Fortuna Frau in 2012, and start with a short video to show you our museum that is created studied by Michele De Lucchi. Leadership is my office, like I say, work each day for find, yes, innovation, research, new possibility, but also work for obtain the opportunity in production on the leather. And quality, like I know, don't understand, is really important for us. Clearly, that is most important for us when sensible. Semi-hamming is for me just a perfect compromise. And finish a pigment if you don't have don't want problem with this. We have 11 collection and in total 181 color. So it's possible make really like a customization. Color system is our best-seller leather because I think that more or less 60-70% of our product is in color system. The leather that is on this chair, that name is Haida. Heritage is a leather that I love. It is a pull-up leather that come from a raw material based in North America. We use for a whole other article European raw material. For this article, we use North America. Two cases we have in our article that leather come from North America. One is of this, and the other one is for Ferrari leather. Ferrari leather is the raw material that comes from North America. Mass leather is our semi-handling leather that is on Archibald and San Luca. It's a semi-handling leather. The sole leather is our semi-handling that represents more or less 10% of our product. Century is a leather that is born in 2012 for our centenary. It's like a stonewash leather. Cavallino is just a name, it's not a horse, but is a cow, like you can imagine. Saddle is a Tuscany saddle. Just a point. We use principally leather that come from Italy, yes, but in the Vicenza area, Halzignano. In this case, we use leather that come from Santa Croce because it's a vegetable tan. Video. This chair we present last year just to give possibility to customization for our customer. The back of the seats in is in saddle and we painted by hand the back. And what we want communicated is a craft machine through leather kits.
Thank you so much. Hi, Steve. How are you?
How are you?
Very well. I'm so excited to talk about the leather and automotive industry and their connections, especially since so many exciting things happening there. I know you have a presentation for us too, but I do have a question for you. So we've seen the use of leather actually decline a bit in the U.S. and the Chinese automotive sector. Can you tell us why and what's changed?
It really gets back to the description and to the label. It's really the issue. There's no question there's a cost difference, and that certainly does play into it by some of the OEM decisions, frankly. In what they're putting together now with vehicles, with the technology, with the safety measures, with the gadgets, et cetera, they've got to pack a lot of information, a lot of products into these vehicles. And certainly when they look at cost-saving opportunities, the synthetic product versus the leather is certainly going to again, it gets back to the labeling and the true description of the consumer to make sure they understand, because they have an option. They do have an option to either select the synthetic or select the leather interior if they know what it is. So it does come back to the same thing we talked about earlier. And frankly, that's all we continue to ask for. That's that'll be my very last slide. And the word has come up in many of the talks already today, and that's transparency. There needs to be clear transparency on that, because leather is a wonderful product. And again, I'll talk about it here in a second, but we have conducted many, many different consumer research studies over the last 10 years, and unanimously the feedback from the consumer is they prefer leather. It's unbelievable the ratio of that particular data, and we've certainly shared that with our customer, they get it, but at the end of the day, they're trying to run a business, and that's why now the initiatives are ongoing right now with Leather Naturally, with One for Leather, with the LIA effort. We've really got to get to the consumer and get the message out there and have, basically allow them 10 seconds to make the decision. If they decide it's synthetic, fine. But from what we've seen, the preference is left.
I think you hit a lot of good buzzwords: transparency, consumer, and education. And I know you have a presentation for us.
Mike?
Yeah? All you? Do you want to take a mic?
Let me get my props up here. First, while I'm doing that, is Frank still here? Did he leave? I was going to offer him a consulting job here to go to Europe with me next week to see all our European amps, so I've got to get his number if anybody's got it. So, he hit such a home run, exactly what we're up against the secondly, I want to let everybody know that 2 years ago I spoke at this Congress in Shanghai, and my presentation slot right after lunch, and I had to deal with all of the headline. So, in this case now, John rewarded me by putting me right at the end, so I understand this, okay? Yeah. I'm going to move as fast as I possibly can. All right, so first of all, what I'd like to do is I'm going to cover just a few macro industry highlights for you, and then we're going to drill down and pivot to more of the surface material. So this graph is a graph of the global automotive bill that is projected from 2014 to 2025. And folks, this is an extraordinary volume story. And even though that basically here this year, China is down, which frankly is the first time in the last 15 years after a phenomenal growth streak they've had, there is softening in North America, there is softening in Europe, but still the projection over the next few years, as you can see, is a steady growth up to roughly 105 million vehicles by 2025. And really, you know, this industry, it fuels thousands of companies and millions of jobs around the world, and the infrastructure is significant. So for us, even though it's a very, very demanding market for us, a very demanding set of customers, we only have 15 or so around the world, it's worth it, because for us to be part of this industry, this volume justifies it. So the next page, going a little bit further, and again, it's not any surprise that the two regions that are driving that growth are China and Southeast Asia. We've talked about it a lot for other industries. Super important for us in automotive. And that's where a tremendous amount of focus, I mean, quite frankly, that's where a lot of the issues are right now in terms of the labeling, et cetera, are in China. But also, an interesting note here is if you take a look at the small bullet there, by 2035, China is saying that they are going to demand, target, 40% of the vehicles that are built will be electric. And typically when China says they're going to do something, they're going to do it. So if you look down at the second point, the new energy vehicle companies, these are five companies here that, frankly, I've hardly heard of, and I'm sure most of you have not heard of, but these are new companies that right now that are leading the way in the electric vehicle development. So whether they're going to be here in 2035, this is our projection along with some industry analysts of who the top five local companies look like they will be moving forward. So we meet 10 years from now, we may have guest speakers from these companies as well, but it is certainly in China. It's going to be a reality in China, we believe, before anywhere else in the world in terms of large volume. The next bullet point, again, no surprise, these are the five leading global OEM companies around the world. This has typically been the ranking for several years now, but for us in our business, obviously the luxury OEMs are very important too. So even though you don't see a BMW, Daimler, a JLR, Volvo up on this page, it's super important for us because of the amount of leather that they're using. The next three bullet points are statistics that I think are significant here for us to talk about. First of all, the luxury market. So I talked about 100 plus million vehicles a year. Basically, the luxury vehicle production will be 10% of that. And for us in the leather industry, we have got to dominate that sector. Now, we're going to obviously continue to look to expand other segments, but this segment we've got to dominate, and this is the one where there have been some concerns here in terms of that real estate. So again, it's a strong projection for us in the luxury end of this business going forward, especially as we cross that 100 million barrier. The next statistic I want to share with you is the amount of surface material real estate. I'm going to use that term a couple times here in the next few minutes. Basically, in 2020, we are projecting plus or minus 5 to 10% that 5.5 billion net square feet of material is going to be used, and this is primarily for seating on the global vehicle build around the world. And what that is made up of is obviously our leather, synthetics, fabric, and suede. And in the past, we have typically competed against our leather competitors. That's been the battle because really our share has remained constant. But what's happening now, we have to look at this real estate. We have now got to look at this 5.5 billion and the amount of synthetic that is taking over, we've got to get that position back. And that's, again, getting back to us doing an industry job to try to get the message out to the consumer because they're the people when we go to the dealership that can make a difference for us and steal back some of that real estate. The next bullet, again, a stat that is frankly pretty staggering. That since 2014, we're projecting out here to 2019, the automotive leather market has gone down 30% from a revenue standpoint. Roughly $4.5 billion in 2014, we're projecting it to be, again, plus or minus 5 to 10%. At a $3.2 billion level this year. Now, a couple of things are occurring. Number one, the pricing has gone down significantly because a lot of our prices are based on high cost index. And we all know what's happened to the high cost. Secondly, it's the decontenting. It's putting more of the synthetic into the vehicle, either part of the leather seat or actually the entire seat, the entire vehicle being synthetic. And I'm talking about Mercedes E-classes. I'm talking about BMW 5 Series. It's really crazy how much it's really starting to permeate throughout the industry. And then the other point is that, again, major reductions, major decontenting are occurring here in the U.S. and China. Europe is pretty pure, but in Europe, as most of you know, typically they will go in and buy a car, they'll sit down in a dealership, and they will actually spec out what they want, a la carte. It'll take 8 weeks to deliver, but they get what they want. In the U.S. and China, people go into a dealership, there's 200 vehicles, and they get what's on that lot, and the salespeople are trying to sell what's on the lot, and they want to move. So it's a little different dynamic, and again, that's part of the world. And then finally, the industry initiatives. And we're so happy, as I mentioned earlier, Leather Naturally is going to kick off their campaign in probably August, One for Leather, which is a group of leather suppliers in Europe, are going to kick off the One for Leather campaign probably July, August as well. A little bit different message, but a very similar theme to consumers, et cetera. And then, of course, John's effort with the LIA sent in an extraordinary study and proposal to the FTC. So we're doing the right thing, and hopefully this momentum is going to take place. All right, so now I want to pivot to the surface material slide here. So first thing we're going to talk about is the synthetic coated fabric, PVC and PU. And this is the material that is slowly creeping into our neighborhood, into our real estate. And frankly, I think I speak for our industry. We respect these synthetic products, but for what they are, they've got a place,
No question. If you want an easy-to-clean product, that's fine. But it is not leather. And it is not right for the labeling not to be clear and for it to be mistaken to be leather. And that's what our theme is going to continue to be, is that, as I said earlier, the consumer deserves to understand the description of the product that's inside the field. So again, it's an issue. Now, in terms of taking a look at the chemistry steps, there's way too many syllables in here for me to go through that with you. You can see it. But basically, in a nutshell, what we're talking about here with these synthetic products is basically we've got plastic. We've got man-made material. We've got products that basically are very, very industrial, petroleum-based, whether it's PVC, PU, and in essence, the way it's produced, the chemistry is rolled onto a skin carrier through a series of rolls. It is basically compacted, and then it is transferred to a fabric substrate, which again, by the way, is man-made, petrol-based, and then it's rolled up in Boston and it's shipped out. So again, it's not a very interesting process, very industrial, very continuous, but again, it is what it is. Now the next product is fabric. So again, the fabric, getting back to the real estate, getting back to the neighborhood, fabric has its niche, and it clearly is not competing with leather. And it's always, consumer understands fabric, they know what they're getting, but again, we're dealing with a product here that frankly has got tremendous options in color, endless, infinite options of color, pattern, very intricate technologies, knitting and weaving to produce the products. But again, plastic, primarily polyester in the case of automotive fabrics. Plastic, petroleum-based, man-made. And once you tie in the ends of yarn and fibers to make the product, you turn on the switch, and it's continuous. It rolls, you send out rolls, and again, it's not a very unique, it's not a very expressive operation in terms of being handcrafted. But again, it's got its place in the industry. And then finally, we've got our product. This is the enhanced natural material. For those of you that are not leatherheads in the audience, we know we have a lot here, take a look at the number of steps these go through. The number of times that hands touch these products from one step to another. This is hand craftsmanship. Every single eye has got a unique story. And that's what we try to convey to our customers, is understand the beauty of this product, the story, and basically, you can see there's nothing like that. So for us, it's we play in this automotive industry, we play in a zero defect world. Everything else on that vehicle has got to be perfect, to spec, to detail, to dimensions, et cetera, et cetera. What we try to promote is that our product is the perfect imperfect material. And that to us is what is attractive to leather, and that's what we continue to try to separate ourselves from the pack regarding the surface material network. So then the next couple of slides, what I want to share with you is I have to share these. And there's two or three slides regarding the recent nasty propaganda from the NGOs that are really being conveyed to a lot of our customers, a lot of the executives, and this is, you know, the first one being that it's coming out to many of the executives we deal with around the world is the fact that we kill the animals for the hides, which we all know is crazy. And basically, this is where we've been going back to the customer and say, listen, it's where it all began. I mean, mankind has been needing to get protein to survive for centuries. And they were ingenious enough back then to take, just like you talked about, we take the hides and they use them for warmth, for shelter, and also for clothing over the years. And I guarantee you, if we look closely enough, in Freddie Flintstone's buggy, they probably had leather seatbelts. But again, it's not a new breakthrough, but we're dealing with this. This has been going on for centuries, and that's a message that again, we've got to continue to convey to the industry. And secondly, again, we've seen this already today, these are the statistics, and Protein is required for nutrition. Nutrition is required for life. And these are the projections out to 2019 and 20 in terms of the cattle population and also of beef consumption. So if, in fact, this is going to remain, demand is going to remain somewhat steady, then our industry is going to continue to thrive. But we've got to preserve the volume. And again, it gets back to the messaging to our customer of why leather is different than things. The next criticizing point that we're getting from these from the NGOs is the fact that the facilities have got issues with environmental malpractice, with sustainability, with animal welfare, and traceability. So this is going to be the cornerstone, quite frankly, of the One for Leather campaign that's going to be kicked off in July or August. It's going to be a big part of it, the initial phase. And this is a page here that frankly, one of our top suppliers, one of the leading animal protein producers in the world, shared with me from their company profile. And again, there is a tremendous amount of sophistication out there right now in our industry that needs to be shared with our customers. They need to see what we have done as an industry. That no longer are these horror shows out there of facilities and welfare and labor, et cetera. We have very, very sophisticated standards now within the industry protect ourselves, and this is what the One for Leather campaign is going to make sure that they focus on going forward. This is as an example. We think that the companies in this industry now have got it, and it's a big part of how we operate. So really, in conclusion, at least for this part of my talk, and then I'm going to go to some eye candy, is basically our message each and every day when we see our customers around the world, designers, engineers, commercial, et cetera, is that leather is a luxury symbol. And as I talked about the consumer research studies we've done, people aspire and prefer the genuine leather products. And we have to continue to press them. It's an important part of our existence, and it is such a different product than the alternatives in our neck of the woods, that leather is going to have to sustain. So those four words that you see on the top of the page here, I think everyone in here, and anybody out on 18th Street, when they think about these four words, there's a warm feeling, and that's the emotional connection of leather. There just is something about leather that's different, and we think, again, this is a story here that needs to be continually told. All right, now what we do continually as a company is we research different auto shows, different trade shows, for our internal inspiration from a design standpoint, but also our design customers around the world do ask us to bring in what trends we're seeing out there, predominantly in different design shows, et cetera. So what I'm going to share with you is that our team has been out here in the last few months, and I've got pictures from the Milan Furniture Fair, as well as the Geneva Auto Show. So first of all, the Milan Furniture Fair. So on the left there, you can see a basket that typically might have been a wood product, now 100% leather, very, very unique. And the right-hand side is a Louis Vuitton chair that if this autonomous vehicle thing really hits 2030, 2040, this may be what a seat looks like in the backseat. Who knows? But a very unique seat. Next is the Pininfarina Battista. The uniqueness on this one is take a look at the colors on the seat. This is something that we think is intriguing and probably can take hold. Typically, all the vehicles have got a common color in all of the different seating areas. You can see the navy and the tan seats, and of course also the updated quilting effect, which has gotten a tremendous amount of popularity lately in the automotive world. So really a couple of points on this one. Next, in the Bentley section, again, the quilting effect, which is getting very, very popular, along with the piping, the navy piping, and the contrast. And on the far right side, there was a lot of green in the show, and also high gloss in the leather. So this is what we put in here for demonstration as well. So it appears to be a trend. This is the kind of information we'll share with the OEM customers so they can see what's happening out in furniture shows, in apparel shows, because they'll take that and they'll go to work, and some of these actually do come back into the automotive market at some point in time. Next is the Lamborghini. It's a very unique seat set here. As you can see, it's a combination of leather
And Alcantara, the white is the leather, the black is the Alcantara suede. Also on the dashboard picture, that is Alcantara in the top hat and leather on the bottom. So again, a nice combination on the concept car. Next is the Bugatti, fantastic color. If you take a look at the tires, that's a really neat effect they put there. But the other key point here is typically embroidery in the past has been used to actually describe certain images of names, Jeep, Wrangler, you name it, etc. In this case, it's actually a design effect. So this is an embroidery effect, which is a little bit different than what's been used in the past. And then the second point here is take a look on the left-hand side of the picture. Again, this is a blue door panel and a charcoal door panel. So again, a contrasting or combination of color on door panels, which is different than we've seen. Next is the Lagonda, the Aston Martin Lagonda. What's unique here, we've got four different natural products. It's a woven leather carpet, and then it's a combination of the seating and door areas of silk, cashmere, and alpaca. So again, it was wonderful to see this, considering all of the synthetic products we talked about earlier, the fact that we've got this vehicle that has done a concept car, all natural products. Next is Maserati, and here they partnered up with Xenia and Giorgetti for woven leather interior components, wood effects, as well as silk fabric, and he inserted that product as well. So again, the natural effect, it's very refreshing to see that on a concept car coming out from Maserati as well. Lexus, a combination of quilting and random perforation. This particular design theme is pretty prevalent right now in today's market, but it continues to be what can you do with the surface effects to get more and more interest with these leather interiors, and we're having many different options, many different color options coming our way in the future as well. And again, something to distinguish ourselves amongst the other surface material options. Rolls-Royce, embroidered leather on the door panel. You can see a unique headliner. This is a leather headliner with LED lighting that they're promoting can be customized to the constellation pattern of your birthday. So, for your next Rolls-Royce, keep that in mind when you go to the dealership. That's what you can ask for. But it's, again, a tremendous effect, obviously, that only Rolls can do. And then finally, we've got the Rolls-Royce, the Mansory Billionaire Edition. Again, another embroidery effect here. Again, not as much necessarily in terms of actually scripting out a certain word, etc., but actually used for design effects. So, again, a tremendous effect here in the whole interior. A lot of light colors, you can see that as well. And again, that's why we have such a need for the anti-soil technology going forward. We've had tremendous breakthroughs from our partners. Thank you very much, those of you that are out there. So that was just, again, a little bit of an oversight of some of the shows we've been to here in 2019. But the last slide here that I want to share with you about early transparency. So again, I'm just going to stay on that theme. Frankly, two ways. One, we're getting a lot of demand from our customer to go backwards and try to understand the traceability of the animals. It's a very, very difficult task for us to get past and go all the way to the ranches, but we've got to work with that. And that's something that the immediate people of all voters need that we have. And we're working on maybe a secluded number of cattle in the United States to be able to do that. That is a need, but then going forward, it is the transparency to just allow the customer to understand what's in the vehicle. And I promise you, those of you that are in the U.S. or China, now that you've heard this coming out of my mouth the last 20 minutes, go to a dealership, ask them to explain what that product is, the material in the vehicle. And I'm going to tell you, unfortunately, probably more than 50% are going to give you the wrong answer. And that's the problem. And that's all we're suggesting, is educate and provide the real skills. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you. question's not just for this panel here, which I thought was terrific, but also on the previous panel. And Steve, I think, fantastic presentation you made there. I'm with you there, though. You know, you're in the garage, and the guy says, this is leather. You say, no, it's fake leather, or it's synthetic leather, or it's synthetic, it's PU. And they said, no, it's leather, I guarantee it. Just smell it, oh, just go and buy it. So yes, a huge learning curve has to be made by the industry. And I go back to people from Coach and from Tory Burch as well, in terms of neither mentioned that they had an issue in regards to whether things were leather or non-leather, which is encouraging in a way, because does it mean to say that there is no competition? But it seems to me that all the cars you were talking about, sir, were mid to top end. Most of what Coach and Tory Burgess is mid to top end. Does that mean to say there's a sort of price level where people start to ask, and it means that they're environmentally thinking about whether these issues are really important to them? Do people, when they go to the supermarket and they buy a carton of milk, do they want to know what cow it comes from? So the question I'm asking is really in terms of, is there a level where people are saying for Louis Vuitton, or for Rolls Royce, or for Tory Burch, it's leather, it's fantastic, I'm going to buy it because the brand is so strong. Anything beneath it is questionable, and therefore I'll ask, are the millennials who are in the audience here today worrying about, saying, utilizing athleisure materials, and materials made out of petroleum products, which are going to stay with us forever? A question.
Lots to unpack there. I think it's multiple things to discover. So I'm going to pass the mic and let you start. Sure.
From the research studies we did, there is a level there where, and it gets back to the label thing, that there's many consumers that don't care. And for them, if they get synthetic or they get fabric based on the level, the segment of the vehicle they're buying, they're fine with it. No question about it. But there are many, many, many people that prefer leather. And whether it's in the top end or drifting down to certain segments, they do like leather. They like the story. They like the fact that leather's been part of their life in many different ways, many different articles in their household for years, and they want the real leather. What's happened, I won't get too lengthy on this, but I'll tell you what happened in this. So back in the mid-90s, in the automotive world, 90% of the surface material was fabric. 10% was leather, only in the luxury end, and there was no synthetic because the products were inferior, absolutely, virtually zero. So what happened is an explosion occurred back in the mid-90s, primarily in the U.S., and China wasn't even aboard at that time, but in the U.S., with the family vehicles and the SUVs, where then the families were looking for material that could be cleanable. Well, the only material that was cleanable was leather in the portfolio of the OEMs, so leather became that alternative product. So leather went from 10% to 30% like that, between 95 and 2000. Not in Europe. Europe has always remained a luxury product. 15 to 20%, it's had its place, and it stayed that way. But in the US, it exploded. So what's happened now is people grew up in that age, the millennials and the Gen Xs, who basically in their vehicle, it wasn't fabric, it was leather. And it was called leather, it was highlighted as leather. But in a lot of cases, it was because it was cleanable. So what's happened here in the last 5 to 8 years is that the synthetic products have gotten better. They do meet the requirements. In fact, a couple of young ladies during a break were talking about that. Well, do they meet the performance? Yes, they do. But they're not real. So they now have decided, the OEs, because it's such a cost disparity, and we'll never touch that, is they're going to put the synthetic in as the alternative, because it still has that leather effect to it, it's still cleanable. And now people still think they're getting leather because it is not described adequately enough for the consumer to really understand. Because most of them, over the last 20 years, anything that wasn't fabric was leather. And that's what's happening.
Give us 2 minutes.
question for us is very difficult to answer because in the automotive industry, we work for high-end quality. And keep in mind that customer for Ferrari on the best, the most luxury material that is possible to have. So is this no question for us? Because in that position, there are holy land. The question is to respect the expectative of the customer, the customer of Ferrari. So we must work to obtain a really performance leather, but at the same time a leather that has a property, organoleptic property, that like touch and feeling. I can't respond, I can answer about the general market in the automotive industry, because we work only for OEM and this part of the car.
Ari, do you want to respond from a design aesthetic standpoint?
Sure. So as far as fashion, Victoria Birch and Coach both offer bags that are made out of PVC as well as leather bags. But you can see the price reflection here. I do feel like, however, millennials, and I'm a part of Gen Z, we are looking for quality products that aren't going to fall apart, and characteristically, PVC, vinyl, PU, at some point, they're not, they just don't last nearly as long as leather. You're not going to get a quality product that's going to last you 2-3 decades. And although you can clean PU, there's something a little bit more sentimental about something that's made out of leather. And I definitely think we're on the curve of trying to get into more authentic materials that are really lasting us a lot.
Thank you. Do we have any other announcements that we have to make? Do you have a question? No? Okay. I think that's it then, guys. Thank you so much for joining us. I believe there's a question about it. Thank you.
let's have a big round of applause again for her.
Having a product that people can really enjoy, resonate with, and give me positive feedback about, like, touches my heart. I'm trying not to cry. But yeah, thank you so much. And you can go on my website at ra500.com and to see any new updates and to also see when my collection is going to officially release. So thank you again so much. Have a great one.
Surprise for you. Together with the work comes a prize, which is an all-inclusive trip to Milan. During the next Milan from the 2nd to the 4th of October 2019. This prize is offered by Lina Pelle. So congratulations again. So we'll see you in Milan. And visiting Lina Pelle and attending all the conferences that we held in the fair will enhance your studies and will give you the opportunity to gain your fashion expertise both on fashion, consumer, and trade areas. So congratulations again. And congratulations to all the other students as well. Part in the contest. All of them create very beautiful, amazing, innovative projects that all jurors, myself included, and the public really appreciated. And I would like to thank the Parsons School of Fashion of New York for their collaboration in this amazing contest and exhibition. Many thanks to Jane Francis. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to be here. Today, she's the assistant professor of fashion product of BFA fashion course at Parsons. She supervised the work at Parsons together with Natalie there. Really wish to thank her for her excellent job. But I would like to invite Muriel Favaro, who is a colleague, she's here, from the Parsons. She's an experienced member of the school and an assistant professor as well.
Yeah. On behalf of Parsons students and faculty, thank you so much, Lina Pelle and Alessandra. You gave us this very generous gift of leather, and students always have difficulty having access to different skins in New York from local supply. So that was so inspirational to them. They got to see many, many surfaces, colors, nothing that they could have had access to any other way. And then Alessandra worked personally with students who had specific needs. So it's also a great financial support. So thank you so much. And I wanted to add the last thing. As we all know, leather is associated with luxury. Like, somehow everyone respects leather, and as far as sustainability goes, everyone goes into slower designs with leather, knowing that it's a luxury material, and we just have to respect it. So, thank you.
Lastly, I hope to see you over the next 2 days at the Lina Pelle New York Show, which is starting tomorrow and will take place here in the Metropolitan Pavilion on the ground floor. So I hope to see you over the next 2 days. And now I would like to invite Lisa Owlett, who is the president of the Italian International Council of Tanners and Leather Industries Association, for the conclusions. Thank you so much.
Real quickly, This is a day and age where a lot of fiction is being thrown out all over the place, and it's very difficult for a lot of people to separate fact and fiction. So regardless of what walk of life you're in, where in the supply chain you are, I encourage everybody to do your utmost to pass out the facts. Things should be databased, and they should be scientifically based, and everything else should be thrown away in the garbage. And I agree, those cows are not my buddies. They are cute, but they're not my buddies. So we do need to work together to make sure that all the fiction is dispelled. And I sincerely hope that the program today has started, especially young people that are in the design and fashion industry, to understand the difference. And we appreciate you coming very much, very much. And again, I want to thank John and Steve and Paul and Luca and all the members of the Lydia Pelli team. It was a wonderful day. I had nothing to do with it other than speaking a microphone a couple times. So to the speakers, to the attendees, to the special guests, to everyone, thank you very much. It was a delightful day. I'd like to introduce Dr. Professor Mwini, who is going to be the incoming president of International Council of Tanners. And if you all are lucky, he's going to give you a short commercial. I didn't get a glass of wine for lunch, so I'm stressing short commercial. Thank you all very much.
Shot four times, so I'll make sure that I do respect that. So my work is very easy. First of all, I just want to say hello to everybody, and at the same time I want to say thank you for all the organizers of this auspicious occasion we had together with you. And just to tell you that the next time around, all of you are welcome to Africa, and I just want to show you a little bit of some video, and I'm done. So, I don't know if you can see my hand signal over there. There we are.
The place where civilization began. The origin of mankind. Places that make you feel connected to nature. Hottest and coldest place on earth. Africa is majestic. Sustainable, equitable, and stable society with strong social tie. Nature, people, culture, livestock, and lifestyle are intertwined. See what Africa has made. while touching so many lives. Leather for health. Leather for wealth. Leather for luxury. All eyes are on the growing African leather sector. Join us. Welcome to Africa, Ethiopia, Addis Ababa, the diplomatic capital of Africa. The place where all Africans converge. A city with good facility. Book your flights today.
Thank you very much. Wow, that was quite short. I just want to tell you that in Africa we're waiting for you. We are all expecting you to come. Come and join us. This is the first time such an organized occasion is really being organized in that continent. We're going to have the IOTCS, and then the following year we're going to have the World Leather Congress in Nairobi. So we're making sure that we spread you in two great towns in Africa. It's short, it's nice, it's genuine, it's natural, and we are hospitable. Thank you very much.